Highbridge, a division of Recorded Books, presents Dinner with Buddha by Roland Merullo. Read by Sean Runnette. Though we do not wholly believe it yet, the interior life is a real life, and the intangible dreams of people have a tangible effect on the world. James Baldwin. 1. I had a dream last night, my sister said, and I knew, by virtue of some mysterious sibling intuition, that I was about to enter a territory of great risk. I had just arrived from the airport in Fargo, rental car cooling in the driveway, bags not yet unpacked. Cece and I were sitting on the porch of what had once been our parents' house, a wood-frame, white-clabbered structure that overlooked 2,000 acres of prime North Dakota farmland. It was nearly dusk, the high plains' August heat had eased a bit, and we were relaxing in wicker rockers on the shade of that old porch, sipping from glasses of my sister's magnificent mint lemonade, and gazing across the acreage, leased now, that still produced Durham wheat with a vibrancy the gods themselves envied. We had been speaking of her daughter, my niece, a 7-year-old girl named Shelsa. According to my sister, Shelsa was a great spiritual being who'd been born in this time and place to save the world from cataclysm. Other people, sane, good, intelligent people, seemed to believe this as well. As for her uncle, yours truly, Otto Ringling of Bronxville, New York, I preferred a compassionate neutrality on the subject. Shelsa was a wonder of a child, yes. Beautiful, quick-witted, graceful, often mature beyond her years, and she loved me with a pure love I clearly didn't deserve. But a great spiritual incarnation? A kind of saint? A female Dalai Lama of the American Midwest? I simply could not make myself go there. Much as I loved her, adored her might be a truer word, and as much as I loved my sister and her famous guru husband, Volya Rinpoche, there were limits to my open-mindedness. When it came to my sister especially, there were limits to the kinds of words I liked to hear, the kinds of food I would eat, the kinds of ideas I'd allow into the cluttered manger of my mind. I did not, for example, believe in one of her many specialties, past life regression. I respected vegans and vegetarians, but knew I'd never join them. Thanks to Rinpoche's kind tutelage, I'd been a diligent meditator for a period of 8 years. And even with everything that had happened to me in that time, I still clung to the meditation practice as if it were a tree branch in a stormy lake, and I was a novice swimmer. But in almost every other way, I'd made a sharp turn away from the disciplined life. During those years, there had been several emotional and psychological body blows. I'll go into detail a little later. And I'd started keeping irregular hours, gained weight, wandered off the spiritual path into an all-American backwater of TV watching and semi-indolence, a therapy of game shows, takeout meals, and bottles of red wine. It was a dark night of the soul, maybe. Or maybe just a kind of tiredness that left me living inside an old shell of decency, devoted fatherhood, and a sophisticated cynicism I associate with Greater Manhattan. I wasn't sure any longer that there were answers to the big questions. Why we suffer, why we die, why we're born in the first place. I wasn't sure there were answers and wasn't even sure I wanted to ask the questions. In a series of handwritten letters sent over a period of many months, my brother-in-law had assured me that my difficulties represented nothing more than one stage on a long spiritual journey. Perhaps I should have embraced that idea. The spiritual life was, after all, his profession. But some pouty, childish voice in my thought stream, as he called it, proudly resisted. Whatever the benefits might be, I did not want just then to do any more interior work. I wanted to laze in the jacuzzi of the well-fed life. I wanted mindless, harmless distraction. I deserved, I told myself, some rest. It was an amazing dream, Otto, Cece was saying. Some kind of spirit. It had no face or body, but seemed to be a woman spirit, was speaking to me. She had a strong accent. Her voice was gentle and absolutely certain. Quiet, like a breeze across grass. But there was nothing conceited about it. She was just absolutely sure, unbearably kind. She was speaking to me the way a loving mother would speak to her daughter. I took a long draught of lemonade, swallowed, nodded agreeably, watched the tips of the wheat shudder in the evening breeze. "What was the woman saying?" I asked, to humor her. I knew from my sister's tone of voice and from other conversations in our long history together that all this was leading someplace, and I suspected it was someplace I didn't want to go. I was having a psychic moment. I was reading the aura of her words. My hopes for a restful North Dakota vacation were, something told me, about to be sent up the well-known creek. Cece, also known as Cecilia or Celia, hesitated, made a quiet humming sound, lay her head back against the top of the chair, and smiled. She was telling me that Shelsa was destined to meet one of the other great spirits who's on the earth at this time. She was saying, "It was so convincing, brother, that Shels and this spirit were going to meet very soon. Actually, we're supposed to help them meet."
"We, meaning you and I?"
"You and Rinpoche, I'm sure, almost sure, were the people she had in mind. But the important part was that they had to meet. Very soon. The world's in crisis.
I've noticed.
And the two of them are supposed to help lead us out of the danger zone and into a new era."
"What does the new era look like?" did the woman say.
"Are you making fun?"
"Not at all."
She didn't say, but I could feel it. "They'll usher in a world with less violence done to each other and to the earth, less divisiveness, less hatred and greed. Not paradise exactly, just something better, kinder. Maybe some sort of new religion with one commandment: don't hurt other people. I'm not sure."
I rocked back and forth, trying hard to imagine Cece's kinder universe, trying, through the curtain of my well-honed East Coast cynicism, to picture a world without torture and war, an America that didn't have hungry children and billionaires living within a mile of each other, an international agreement to spend massive sums on medical research and education rather than on weapons systems, a planet that was nurtured rather than poisoned. It didn't work. I watched the tips of the wheat, our own amber waves of grain, shiver and go still. It seemed to me that it was precisely the news of the world, this harsh, real world, that had chased me from New York to North Dakota for what I told myself would be a restful 3-week summer vacation on the old homestead. From every direction came reports of shootings and sexual abuse, extremism, corruption, political stalemate at the expense of the poorest among us. Two Americas, as a famously disgraced presidential candidate had once said. The rich getting richer, the schools in trouble, the environment in ruins, the NSA listening in, bombs at the Boston Marathon, plus radical Islamists killing people in Africa and the Middle East in the name of their vengeful God. Sadness on all fronts, it seemed. Of course, that was and always had been part of the human condition, and I was a fool to think I could escape it, even for 3 weeks. If North Dakota had ever been a refuge of the quiet life, all that had gone away with the discovery of a method of squeezing oil and gas from the stone that lay beneath its surfaces. If our childhood home had ever been a paradise of small-town safety, of neighborliness and simple faith, much of that was gone now. I'd stopped for a leg-stretching stroll in Dickinson, the nearest city. It had seemed hot and dead. Bars, empty storefronts, chain restaurants peddling unhealthy food. Now, during every hour of the day and night, much of North Dakota was kept awake by enormous trucks carrying away the lifeblood of the Bakken oil fields. Tough men and hard women had invaded the Peace Garden State. We could feel the change all around us. Bright lights on the prairie at night, traffic clotting the roads, prostitution, fistfights on the streets, no eggs on the grocery shelf, a stabbing in Bismarck. people locking doors that hadn't been locked in generations. It sounds good, I said to my sister, a world like that. I can tell you don't believe in it. I'd like to believe in it. I really would. There's just so much evidence to the contrary. That's why we're here, she said. That's why you and I met Rinpoche. That's why Shelsa was born. I clung to a diplomatic silence. I loved my sister, I did. I loved her very much. This woman spirit said you needed to go into the mountains, Celia went on. It was so clear, Otto. She said it several times. The mountains. You have to go to the mountains and find this person who's going to help Shelsa change the world. More silence. Though I wanted to, I couldn't quite look at her. I could feel a roar, no, forming in the space between my lungs. I didn't want to go to the mountains. What did the mountains have to offer? Serpentine roads, provincial mindset, poor internet reception, and an absence of pad thai. I didn't want to go anywhere. I could feel her looking at me, but I kept my eyes forward, fixed on our fields. At last, after considering and abandoning several harsher remarks, I said, "The mountains is not exactly a precise destination. There are mountains everywhere, all over the world." "I know," Cecilia agreed, sadly. I waited. She said, "I think you and Rinpoche are supposed to start with the closest ones and go from there." "Why don't you and Rinpoche go? He's your husband. Shelsa is your daughter." Now it was my sister's turn at silence. I could feel a refutation forming inside her. It would be more or less fact-based, impossible to contradict. At last she said, "Maybe Shelsa and I could join you at some point, when you find the person. But you're Rinpoche's disciple. Really, that's the only word for it, disciple. You have a destiny to fulfill, something you've never really been able to accept about yourself. You're special. I'm just his wife." As predicted. I heard voices and lifted my eyes. On the dirt road that ran past one of our outbuildings, I saw, above a line of bushes, a young face, dark hair, joyous eyes. Shelsa seemed to be riding on horseback, bouncing up and down, but all I could see were her eyes, forehead, and hair. Then the beautiful smile, then her slim shoulders, one arm waving. "Uncle Ott," she was calling. "We are coming to kiss you, Uncle Ott." A dog barked, their beloved Jasper Jr., named after my own lost friend. Another 2 seconds, and it became clear that Shelsa was perched not on the backbone of a horse, but on her father's shoulders. I heard Rinpoche's laugh, a throaty bellow. I saw his face, wide, deeply tanned, hairless, then his big shoulders and arms. He was built, this eccentric Russian monk, like a nose guard on a very good Division III college football team. 5'7 or 5'8, square as a block of quarried stone, and yet somehow as limber as a ballerina. He was dressed, as always, in his traditional maroon robe with gold trim, and he was laughing and bouncing his daughter as if all the world's troubles had blown north on the evening breeze, as if fracking, civil war, arms dealers, and drug cartels could never touch people like us. He might have been 40, and he might have been 70. No one seemed to know. Rinpoche seemed not to care, but he was in tremendous condition. With Jasper prancing happily at his feet, Rinpoche jogged the last 20 yards with his daughter on his shoulders, then swung her down in a sweeping motion so she landed lightly in front of him. "Otto, my friend," he called out happily. "My brother-in-law, I am good to see you." I set down my glass and stepped off the porch into our yard. And the affection I received there, Jasper's warm muzzle, Shelsa's tender hug, and then Rinpoche's, the grasp of a grizzly, was almost enough to alter the world for me. Almost enough to make me believe in my sister's finer universe, in the promise of Shelsa's miraculous future. Almost enough to shake me out of the skin I'd lived in for 51 years, the assumptions about what was real and not real, about why we had been born, and what we might expect to find here in our cauldron of pain and trouble. 2. While this joyous reunion was taking place, my 23-year-old daughter, Natasha, was out running errands in Dickinson. It had been 4 months since I'd seen her, and though we spoke on the phone 2 or 3 times a week and passed emails and other digital burps back and forth through the ether on a daily basis, I missed her terribly. My son Anthony was in college on the East Coast, there already for preseason football, and during the school year I made a point of driving up to Maine to see him every third weekend or so. I'd take him and a friend out to dinner. We might attend a track meet or baseball game. We'd joke and catch up, talk sports and classes, and I'd give him a firm handshake and a hug, slip a 20 into his hand, and get into my car and head back to my empty life in Bronxville. But things were different with Tasha. They had always been different. We'd always had a particularly close relationship, and from the time she was about 4, I'd felt, strangely enough, that she'd arrived in my life to teach me things that no one else could teach me. Jeannie, her mother, felt the same way, and we'd had many conversations about that. I am not a humble man, but I am humble enough to recognize, in my twice-tattooed and occasionally moody eldest child, a strength and wisdom I do not possess. 2 years ago, when her mother and my beloved wife passed away, Natasha dealt with that blow not by overeating and watching too much TV, not by losing faith in the possibility of some divine explanation, but in just the opposite fashion. She left school before the start of her junior year at Brown and moved out here to the retreat center run by Rinpoche and Celia and devoted herself to the spiritual search. She told me she wanted to understand what had happened with her mother, why such things happened, before settling into a more traditional life, career, marriage, children. In short, while her father was floating away from the big questions, clinging to his meditation lifesaver, she was swimming a hard crawl stroke right into them. A quarter hour after the hug fest, Natasha arrived in the retreat center's antique pickup, nicknamed Uma, raising a plume of dust behind her as she came. There were more warm embraces, a few minutes of packing away groceries and making small talk, and then, while Shelsa fed the dog, and while Cece prepared some kind of tofu burgers with miso mustard on top and made a salad composed of leaves and stems no one in my circle of friends had ever heard of, never mind eaten, Tosh and I went out for a stroll. We did this by instinct, without having planned it and without discussing it. There were no meditation retreats in the month of August, no earnest strangers wandering the grounds where Cece and I had played and done chores as children, and where our parents had worked and sweated. No sound of the meditation bell, or Rinpoche's basso chants echoing across the wheat fields. A beautiful silence had settled over our land, a curtain of quiet, broken only by the crunch of our footsteps on the gravel road and the occasional happy burst of song from a meadowlark. For a little while, then, it was the North Dakota of my imagination. "Things good, Dad?" my daughter asked in her cheerful, hopeful way. She had my mother's Northern European aspect, the wide-set pale eyes, the pale freckled skin, and her own mother's mouth. A heartbreaking mouth that stretched effortlessly into the saddest of all smiles and flexed into a frown when she was troubled. She was tall, slim, athletic, beautiful to my eye, capable of great things. And I worried almost constantly that she'd wither away here in this dusty outback, remain single and unhappy, sprinting down a dead-end road into middle age. "Good," I fibbed. "Fine." "And with you?"
"Nice. I have what you'd probably call a love interest."
"Wonderful." "Good guy?"
"Older," she said. "Kind. Really into meditation."
What leapt to my lips was how much older. But I'd learned long ago to tread lightly when it came to Natasha's love interests. I was happy she'd found someone, but she had in this arena a genetic similarity to her Aunt Cecilia. Both of them had loved their way through a string of unusual boyfriends, the wild, the nerdy, the addicted and arrested, handsome and not so handsome, tall, thin, stocky, short, brilliant, and rather slow. Men, young and not so young, who inhabited the fringes of the masculine netherworld. I'd learned to accept it and hoped now only for one outcome, that my daughter's romantic explorations would end up where my sister's had, with a good man who treated her well. So instead of probing, I said, "And how's that going?" The meditation, I mean. Rinpoche's guiding me. He says I'm making progress. But it doesn't feel like progress. It just feels like a gradual, I don't know, a gradual becoming more myself. I'm not afraid of the things I used to be afraid of. Such as Bakken creeps coming on to me in the market. Such as going out for long walks on the farm roads at night. Such as being out on my bike in a thunderstorm. Keep going, I thought. Soon it will be not afraid of getting into cars with strangers. Not afraid of jumping out of airplanes. Not afraid of working as a guard in the state prison. Not afraid of... I said, "As a fearful man, I have to say I'm jealous. Little things, Dad. But it's nice. And it's because of the meditation. Are you keeping up with your practice?" "Sure," I said. "It's the last bastion of discipline for me. I sometimes think that without it, I'd drown in a sea of wine and television." "You've gotten fat." "Thanks. Are you still working out?" "Not as much." "Are you depressed, Dad?" "Not so much." "What do you do all day?" "Oh, you know, I meditate for 20 minutes or half an hour, morning and night. In the middle of the day, I keep busy. A little tennis, reading, TV, seeing friends." "You're depressed." "Right." "You should come out here and live with us. Rinpoche's an expert on depression." "And never experienced it a day in his life, I bet." "No, but still. It's good to be here, hon. Nice to see you in the flesh. To see Rinpoche and Aunt Cece and Shelsa. But after all these years of city life, being here is like downshifting from fourth to second. It's very pleasant, refreshing. But it's not the life for me, Tosh. I left this life a long time ago. I can't go back. And Aunt Cece drives you nuts, right? I love Aunt Cece. I admire her. I'm happy to see her so happy. But she can drive me crazy still, yes." "Have you ever really looked into that, Dad?" "As a matter of fact, I have, many times." "And?" "I think it's because she refuses to see the world as it actually is. She believes that if she eats carefully and prays a lot and is devoted to Rinpoche and Shelsa, all good things, by the way, then she'll escape pain and death. She'll somehow come to inhabit another earth where people don't cheat and murder. We were just talking about it, as a matter of fact. She dreams of a different world, which is all fine and good, except that as far as any rational person knows, that world doesn't exist. She's been that way since she was a girl. She hasn't changed. She thinks," my daughter said in a measured, thoughtful tone that was new to her, "that if she clears her mind down to the deepest level, then three things will happen. She'll never be afraid. It will be easier to love people, and it will be easier to die." This, coming from a girl who'd recently watched her own mother die, stopped me in my tracks. Not literally, we kept walking. We were going past the solitary retreat cabins now, tidy and small, with unpainted wood siding and metal roofs. In my better days, only a few years earlier, I'd made a 3-day retreat in one of them. I marked that as the end of my optimism, the high point of my spiritual attainment. Since then, I'd been gliding down, slowly, almost without noticing. Down and down. My dog had died. I'd grown a belly. Even with the meditation practice, on certain days, in certain difficult hours, my mind was a circus of despair. "You say that," I told Natasha. Then I paused. "You say that in a way that's different from Aunt Cece. She sounds like she hopes it's true. You sound like you know it's true. Is that just what Rinpoche tells you, or..." "Rinpoche is enlightened. You know that, Dad, right?" "I believe I do, yes. I'm not sure what it means, but I believe it.
It means that he doesn't identify with his body and his personality, his I. His mind has exploded out into something much bigger. In Christian terms, it's like Jesus saying, not I, but the Father who lives in me. I can feel something like that from him. I've always felt it. I just don't see it happening to me. Your aunt calls me his disciple. I think that's absurd. I'm his brother-in-law, his friend, his admirer. Period. Enlightenment happens in stages, Dad. You have your ups and downs, and then if you keep trying, it comes over you when you least expect it. Even if you don't pursue what you call the spiritual life. Eventually, sure. Just living makes it happen. The act of being alive is in and of itself spiritual evolution, unless a person purposely resists it. All the pain and pleasure, it's all a lesson. But a spiritual practice is like... She twisted her lips to one side the way I'd seen her do 5,000 times. It's like the difference between a kid who goes to school and learns, and a kid who goes to school and learns and comes home to parents who are reading to her and talking to her about the world, showing her things, teaching by their actions, like what you and Mom did for us. I couldn't speak. It's the difference between somebody who wants to be a good tennis player and goes out and plays once a week and somebody else who wants to be a good tennis player and takes lessons, practices, reads up on the sport, plays a lot. Maybe I'm too lazy for that, hon. I don't want you to be. Why? Why didn't you want me to hang out with Judy Millen when we were little? Because her parents were racist homophobes who believed God loved them and hated your mother and me because we didn't go to church on Sunday and sometimes voted for women. Why didn't you want me to binge drink in college and sleep with just anybody? For obvious reasons, and I don't see the link between binge drinking and the spiritual life. If you love somebody, you want what's good for them. That's the link. I don't want to see my father fat and depressed. Sorry, Dad. And giving up on life. Mom wouldn't want her death to do that to you. I don't want you to grow old and die that way. I want you to really understand what a great person you are, which is something you've resisted all your life. I think there's some weird, I can't possibly be special, North Dakota fake humility there. Have you ever looked at that? I didn't answer. We walked along. On the heels of her loving assault, I tried to think of something funny to say, some wise remark. Some deflection. Natasha had always been able to pierce that artfully constructed armor of mine, an armor that worked so well with my New York friends. At the office, at parties, meeting a neighbor at a cafe in town, or on the front lawn during leaf-raking season, we had a repartee, my acquaintances and I. A hail fellow, well-met bravado. In some cases, a pattern of minor league jousting. Harmless, to be sure, but an armor all the same. Here, in a few sentences, she'd pierced it again. I felt raw, unguarded, shaken up, afraid of something I couldn't name. We went along for another while and then, again without talking about it, turned around and headed back. Only a weak yellowish light remained in the western sky, the last promise of day. Finally, when we were again within sight of the farmhouse, I said, "So tell me about this new boyfriend. Name, age, characteristics." I could feel her smiling next to me. I remembered what it felt like to smile at the mention of a lover. I remembered so well saying the word genie to my friends, and the warm feeling it raised in me. I remembered it as if it were yesterday. "His name is Warren," Natasha said, "and he's got some of that same North Dakota neo-humility I was just talking about. It has a good side." "Sure it does. I love you, I love him. It's just that sometimes I can clearly see those self-imposed limits and it makes me nuts. He's 38, but he looks much younger. He's 6'7", 240 pounds. He played tight end at UND until he got hurt. He's a woodworker, a great one. He has a little furniture shop in Bismarck. He used to have a drug problem, long ago, after the injury, and he went to jail for a few months. Just the county jail, just for shoplifting. But he's way, way past that now. He comes here on retreats 3 or 4 times a year and is a huge, huge fan of Rinpoche. He's going to be staying here to help us out while you and Rinpoche are traveling.
I thought, 38, very nearly twice your age. My daughter involved with an ex-con giant with drug problems, walking alone on the country roads, fending off Bakken creeps, bike riding in thunderstorms.
I said, how did you know we'd be traveling?
It was all set up, she said guilelessly. Aunt Cece has been seeing you in dreams, on the road with Rinpoche. She's been having the dreams for months now. She planned this a long time ago, at least in a loose way. Now she's trying to set up some speaking engagements for him, too, I think, so it all works out.
I came up here to spend time with you, not travel with Rinpoche, much as I enjoy his company.
I know, Dad. I've heard hints and bits of conversation. I think there's something big, a bigger trip, coming up, maybe next year or something. And all of us are going. I'll miss you two more than you'd believe, but I think it's important that you go wherever it is that he's going.
Into the mountains, apparently, I said, and I couldn't keep a droplet of sarcasm from the words. Natasha looked up at me. She stopped, took hold of my shoulders, and kissed me just to the right side of my mouth.
You lost Mom. You lost your job. Jasper. Us. You're depressed in the house. Can't you see, Dad? Everything's pointing you toward something else, a different route. You're not going to be allowed to be just one of those suburban retirees, playing tennis and taking exotic cruises. That's not going to be your fate in this life. Don't fight it. Just let Rinpoche lead you toward something bigger. Just trust him, okay?
Playing tennis and taking cruises doesn't sound so bad at the moment.
She smirked, smiled her sad smile.
Jasper came bounding down the path. I said, can't you and Warren come with us into the mountains?
We need to get the place ready for the September retreatants. If you stay here for a while after you get back, we can spend some time together then. There are things I want to show you here.
I grew up here, hon.
New things. I'd like you to get to know Warren, for one. I'd like us all to go camping in the grasslands. Will you?
I was under the spell of her warmth and love and youthful wisdom then, the very things that had been missing from my life. I was under her spell, and I understood, in some semi-conscious way, that I'd come to the retreat center to be healed again. Failure that I felt myself to be at that moment, I was at least humble enough in the depths of my secret soul to admit that much. I'd come here to be healed. If healing meant going into the mountains with my sister's guru husband in search of a companion for his spiritually special child, then I would do it. If it meant camping in the grasslands with my daughter and her 38-year-old flame, I'd do that too. I told myself I was finished with my regimen of coffee and pastries, gourmet pizza with French fries on the side, TV, and lonely brooding. That was behind me now, merely a stage, a dark night. I won't even unpack my suitcases, I said. Enlightenment in the mountains, here I come. Reserve a campsite for my return. Natasha wrapped both arms around me and said, "That's my wondrous dad." 3. You've gotten fat, Dad, are you depressed? Are not exactly the words one hopes to hear from the daughter one hasn't seen in months. There was no meanness in them. Natasha was a young woman constitutionally incapable of meanness. But she could be blunt, a trait inherited from the maternal side. My wife's mother, in public a woman of substantial social graces, was known around the dining table to make comments such as, "If you marry him, your children will have rather large ears." The him, in this case, was her newish boyfriend, Otto Ringling, who happened to be standing at the top of the stairs in pressed pants and his only dress shirt, heading down for his first family dinner. I paused there, waiting, wondering how Jeannie would respond. And what weight rather large ears carried, not true in any case, they are and have always been perfectly adequate ears, neither more nor less, in no way out of the norm, in the difficult decision a woman makes about who will father her children. And I heard Jeannie say, and rather large penises should they be masculine.
Also, I should add here, well, see above regarding ears. Still standing at the top of the stairs, I stifled an urge to applaud. Mom's, as she was known, waxed apoplectic. In my house we will not have that kind of talk, etc., etc. Jeannie's Uncle Jean, another summer visitor, couldn't stop laughing. And yours truly descended the stairs and inquired, "What's the joke?" The joke, of course, is that bluntness tends to engender bluntness in some bloodlines. In Jeannie's case and in Tasha's, thankfully, the bluntness had stayed, but the nastiness had leached out. Still, Natasha's comment rang a stinging note in my inner ear as I reluctantly made my preparations for the road. Fat is not a nice word. There are many good substitutes. I've used them all in reference to myself. Big works well. Corpulent. Heavy. Stocky. Even chubby is better than fat. What made it worse in my case was that I knew the term fit and knew precisely where the responsibility lay. The equation for weight gain is really very simple. IO over M equals WG. Though, of course, the psychology is anything but. What you take in, I, times what you burn off, O, divided by M, where M is the mysterious workings of one's metabolism. For example, a Polish-American Bronxville friend named Francisco Wardeski could consume 3 slices of pecan pie at lunch twice a week and 5 beers at a friendly dinner party, take no more exercise than that required to walk from bedroom to BMW in the morning and back again at night, and he had the belly of a college swim captain. My own father ate like a rhinoceros. I can still see the 6-high stack of hotcakes on his breakfast plate, next to an order of toast and mayonnaise, bacon, coffee with whole milk, maybe a buttered corn muffin. But he'd spend the whole day in the barns or fields, so his large I was matched by a very large O. My own love of food was legendary. In fact, for the 28 years that I'd been an editor of food books at a prestigious New York house called Stanley and Burns, food had been central to my profession. During those years, thanks to my own vanity and because my wife was not attracted to corpulence, I'd made a concerted effort to get to the gym in winter, the tennis courts in summer, and kick the soccer ball with my daughter and jog with my son at every opportunity. Until, that is, things fell apart. Since Jeannie's diagnosis, 903 days, and especially since the tripartite blow of her passing, my loss of work, and the kid's departure, my formerly respectable waist measurement had gone the way of the 2013 Dow Jones. I had, in other words, let myself get fat. Thinking all this, feeling a tide of shame rising like a septic overflow around my ankles, watching the purple-black cloud of depression creeping in over the horizon, I heard someone padding up the stairs, and then saw Rinpoche standing in the doorway with a hand on each side of the frame. "I am very, very happy," he said. And you could see it was true. His eyes were lit like 4th of July sparklers. The enormous smile caused the skin around his ears to wrinkle. "Glad to hear it." "Why?"
"Because," he said, "in this lifetime, the greatest, best fun for me is to be in the road with my brother and war."
On the road, I wanted to say, correcting. But I couldn't. Fool that I was, lonely, sentimental, wounded, fat, depressed fool, I felt a familiar spasm in the muscles of my throat. Volya Rinpoche, world-renowned spiritual master and husband of my wacky sister, actually seemed to mean it. "Rimp," I managed after a few seconds. "One question."
"Any questions, men?"
"Why is the Buddha so often shown as a fat man? We even have the term Buddha belly to describe the well-known spare tire abdomen." "Why is that? I mean, he was famous for eating practically nothing. What happened?" Rinpoche stared at me as if seeking out the seed of idiocy in the center of my brain.
"Because he eat up everybody's karma all around him, men," he said.
And then, after a pause that seemed atypically indecisive, he added,
"Like Jeannie did."
Jeannie was always thin, always. Even after she had the kids, she...
Not talking food, Otto. Jenny with the pen, the sickness, the dying early. She was taking other people's karma onto herself. You didn't know?
4. Though it is named Stark County, the territory of my youth actually has a certain complex beauty to it, in the non-winter months at least. The fields are sloped and slanting. Western North Dakota isn't flat, not at all. And on hot summer days, the fathomless sky is painted a sharp wildflower blue, and often decorated with rows of puffy cumulus, grand, purple-fringed, towering, that march eastward like the army of some resplendent king showing off on a celestial parade ground. Gravel roads run in a loose grid across land planted in durum wheat, hops, alfalfa, and sunflowers. Rolled bales of hay await collection by the roadsides, or spot the vast landscape like curlers on a head of golden hair. West-central North Dakota is, in mid-August, a palette of gold and green below and purple, blue, and white above, though in winter it better warrants the stark name, and turns white and gray, crackles with cold, and is inhospitable to everything that breathes. On the morning of August 16, 2013, Volya Rinpoche and I, accompanied by my sister and niece, set out across that landscape in search of God knew what. Enlightenment, healing, the soft, bright heart of my sister's silly visions, or possibly the spiritual being who would form the perfect other half to my remarkable niece. Rinpoche and I were headed, supposedly, to the mountains. But on that morning, my state of mind was such that I didn't really care. I had planned to spend a few weeks in Dakota, taking walks with my daughter, playing hide-and-seek with my niece, enduring my sister's watercress and balsamic sandwiches on bread so fibrous it resembled some sort of byproduct from the plywood factory in Williston. Now, however, my daughter had a lover, and my sister had visions. I would go along then, change my ticket, put more miles on the rental car, spend a bit of time at the farm upon my return. What else did I have on my schedule? I was a brittle, brown November leaf, scuttling across an abandoned lawn. I would go where the next breeze took me and make the best of it. Sometimes now I ask myself this question. If I had known on that mid-August day where my sister's visions, where that uneasy breeze would lead me, would I have kissed Natasha goodbye and gotten into the new Ford SUV with Rinpoche, Shelsa, and Cease? Or would I have stayed around the farm for a while, soaking in old memories and the comfort of my daughter's affection, then headed back to Bronxville and the empty house, the familiar pleasures? I chose to repack my barely unpacked suitcase and hoist it into the back of the shiny new Ford, hold my daughter close, climb in behind the wheel, toot twice at Natasha and wave, throw up a cloud of dust, and head west toward Belfield, North Dakota, and Shelsa's favorite eating-out breakfast place, with one last look in the mirror at the white clabbered farmhouse on its rise, and my daughter there, beautiful in the prime of her young womanhood, waving, turning away. "Where to?" I asked in a tone of what can only be described as manufactured bonhomie. Cease was sitting in back with her daughter. Rinpoche was busy wrestling with the buckle of the seatbelt, so there was a short pause before this comment came to me.
"Going away now. Maybe not coming back."
I looked across to see if the monk might be making one of his famous jokes, but there was no sign of humor on his face. "You running away from my sister? I'll get out my dad's old shotgun. I'll..."
"Who's running away?" Shelsa asked from behind me.
"No one, honey," Cece said. "It's just your uncle making a bad joke. Let's play mock."
"Maybe now the change for us," Rinpoche said quietly.
"Meaning what?"
A shrug, an uncharacteristic sigh.
"Celia seeing that now we go another place, all of us. She has the dreams."
"I know those dreams," Sometimes they're eerily on the money. Sometimes crazy. Thanks, Otto.
It's true, sis. Not about money, Rinpoche said. We have plenty.
It's an expression, on the money. Sometimes her dreams are accurate, on the money. Other times they're just wrong.
Sometimes is everybody wrong, he said.
And he turned his head away from me out the side window.
What is the word for light? The different lights, one kind to the other.
Spectrum?
Yes, I like very much this word. On the spectrum, you can see some colors very good, yes?
Sure.
And the others you don't see, yes?
Right, ultraviolet for one. He nodded and turned his head forward again, then toward me.
Doesn't mean the colors isn't there.
Exactly, Cece said between the seats. Precisely. Thank you, my love.
You're welcome.
The Trapper's Skillet restaurant occupied most of a dusty lot just off Interstate 94, on the west side of US 85. 85 is a 1,500-mile road with some character, and one on which I'd spent a certain amount of time as a young man, dating a woman whose parents owned a farm along it. The road runs from Saskatchewan to the Mexican border, slicing down through the Dakotas like a straight blade through dry bread. The terrain it crosses is, in fact, dry. And it does, in fact, at least in the Peace Garden State, include some land where wheat is grown. 85 is one of those old American roads, like its better-known cousin, Route 66, a road with the scent of stagecoach and covered wagons still lingering at either shoulder, a relic from the days before the interstates, when you still felt the soul of a place as you traveled through. The Skillet, as they called it, had apparently become one of Shelsa's favorite spots, a cafe her father liked to take her to early on Saturday mornings in order to give Cece a chance to sleep. It seemed just a bit odd to begin our trip with a pit stop. We could so easily have eaten at home. But Shelsa insisted it would make her very sad if she and her mother didn't join Rinpoche and me for the first part of the journey, spend a night with us, and start with a meal at the Skillet. Her mother had relented without much fuss. The whole voyage had a weird feeling to it. No itinerary, no destination, no direction at all other than the mountains, and a couple or three potential speaking engagements that were being set up last minute. There was something refreshing about the weirdness, however, at least on that first morning, at least for me. It was the kind of trip a young person might take, a trip that promised spontaneity and the risk of minor discomfort, just the tonic for lardy middle-aged discouragement. Because my sister is made nervous by any driver who even approaches the legal speed limit, we went along at a turtle's pace and pulled into the restaurant's Winnebago-cluttered lot as if we'd run out of gas and were rolling to a stop at the pump. One of the Winnebagos had a smart car attached behind, a family of environmentalists, apparently. "So, Shells," I said when we'd finally parked, "this is your favorite place, huh?"
"You will love it very much, Uncle Ott."
Her smile showed the typical second-grade gaps in her teeth. In that way, at least, she was an ordinary girl. "What should I order? Pancakes?" "Egg sandwich," she said in her grown-up way. We walked through the hot morning air, pulled open a door made for weightlifters, and found ourselves in a gift shop that was a menagerie of kitsch. There were posters promoting gun ownership in the strongest terms, small metal placards showing a canoe, and the words, "Up Shit's Creek, no hope, no paddle." There were plastic tags for every birthday and common first name. There were hunting knives, cliched photos of running streams and mountains, wall hangings with sayings like, "Your husband called and left this message, buy anything you want," and, "I say drunk things when I'm stupid." To our right was the restaurant. It was the busboy's day off, apparently. Half the table showed crumpled napkins, plates of unfinished sausage and gravy. We found a clean one near the far window and settled in. Perusing the menu, I kept hearing the word "fat" in my inner ear, and that situation wasn't improved by the arrival of a waiter with veins striping muscled forearms and the belly of a college kid, which he was not. When my turn came, I ordered a bacon and egg sandwich on wheat bread.
Cheese? He asked.
Sure. What kind do you have?
Two kinds, American and white American.
Just plain then, thanks.
No cheese?
Not today. I patted my midsection. Changed my mind.
Diet.
The waiter sent a hard glance at me and at the berobed Rinpoche, who'd ordered oatmeal with a scoop of butter on top and forgotten to say please.
You run the whatever it is, the mosque or whatever, in South Hart, he said to the famous man.
Meditation center, I corrected quickly. He didn't turn his eyes.
You should visit, Rinpoche told him. 3-day retreat. No eating, he laughed.
The waiter studied him. Not kindly or unkindly now, but simply as if he were a rare specimen in these parts. A migrating crane swooping in for butter and oatmeal. He squinted, started to say something else, then turned away. When he was gone, Shelsa remembered that she'd left her stuffed mouse in the car. Topo Gigio was its name. It had been Cece's comfort object more than 4 decades earlier. A gift from my parents, who enjoyed the Ed Sullivan variety show and adored the little Italian mouse who spoke to Ed with a squeaky accent.
Eddie, kiss me goodnight.
I have only a faint memory of the actual show, the memory refreshed by YouTube clips I showed my children. But I remembered how attached Cece had been to the little rodent, the fits she'd throw when it went missing, the care she took with its grooming. These are the things that lodge in the mind of the older sibling. Cece asked if I'd give Shelsa the keys so she could go out and fetch Topo. I was shocked.
You'd let her go out there alone?
She'll be fine.
Fine, I thought.
Fine, as in snatched by some sex offender cruising Route 85 on the alert for solitary kids?
Don't you read the news? I wanted to ask my sister.
But most likely she did not. She sat looking across the table at me with an all-too-familiar, condescending smile pinching her cheeks.
She can't be hurt in the ordinary ways, don't you know that, Otto?
She's protected from all that. Someday you'll understand, brother, the smile seemed to say. Until then, I'll humor you. At that moment, waiting for an already delayed breakfast to soften my mood, there were several things I wanted to say in the direction of that smile. I'm the one who watched his wife die of cancer. You're the one who used to read palms for a living. I worked in Manhattan for 2.5 decades. Manhattan, the epicenter of reality. And I also volunteered for 18 of those years in one of the city's poorest neighborhoods. You live on a farm in North Dakota, and while it's true that the state has changed for the worse of late, you don't get out much. I raised 2 children without major incident, watching them like a father grizzly when they so much as left the table for the restroom at a local cafe. So please, I was tempted to say, spare me the superior smile. But Rinpoche was watching me, and I had the sense, as I often did with him, that he could read my thoughts. That he saw the run of old sibling irritation as clearly as if it were tattooed on my left cheek. It was more than not wanting to look bad in front of him, more even than wanting to keep Shelsa from seeing her uncle's ugly side. Rinpoche's presence was a reminder that there were different ways of doing things. One did not need to indulge one's every irritation. One could watch it rise and let it fall, without denying or embracing it. The way one did with one's thoughts in meditation. I launched a wish for peace, happiness, and sanity in my sister's direction. I said to Shelsa, Uncle Ott wants to see Topo too. Let's go get him before the food comes. Out we went, past the kitsch museum to the SUV. Topo was rescued, clutched to a loving breast. As we walked back to the entrance, I noticed a suntanned man in a cowboy hat staring at my dark-haired companion, standing there idly with his lecherous eyes locked on her. I wanted to snap a picture with my phone and present it to Cece as evidence in the court of sibling disagreement. But as we passed, the man said kindly, That's a special gal you got there. And to Shelsa, And that's one fine rat you're holding. This, she said in her adult-like tone, polite but sure, doubtless, is a mouse. The man laughed in the most unlecherous of ways and apologized, and I felt, as I sometimes did in those difficult days. Quite small. The egg sandwich, served on a hamburger bun, not wheat bread, was perfectly okay. The coffee, drinkable. The hash browns and biscuit were, in the Great Western tradition, unimaginative and filling. But I have to say that a certain sadness hung over the table. The understanding on my part that I'd have my sister's and Shelsa's company for only a day or two. Rinpoche insisted on paying. As we stood at the cash register, he struck up a conversation with the waiter, who'd been giving him something resembling the evil eye on every trip to the table, and who was now doing double duty as cashier.
"How could you make it out?" asked the bald, berobed holy man, whose books were studied by seekers all over the globe,
and whose presence was enough to draw the spiritual-minded from every continent to the wilds of Stark County to live in a simple dormitory room, to eat my sister's cooking, and to sit and watch their thoughts for 8 hours a day. "How could you make it out?" It was his best imitation of a Dickinson rancher. The man looked at him hard. "How am I making out?" "Not bad. Thanks for the nice tip."
"You're welcome, man.
I'm just working here till I can get up to the Bakken."
"The oil place," Rinpoche said. "Good money, yes?"
"Bet your ass."
"Bet your ass," Rinpoche repeated.
He seemed to be making a study of the local dialect, trying hard to fit in. It was odd, given the fact that he'd said not an hour earlier that he might be leaving. "$3,000 a week, my friend."
"What is this grand?"
$1,000. $3,000 a week.
"But work very dangerous."
"I can handle it. How you making out?"
"Road tripped now."
"Whereabouts?"
"Big mountains, maybe."
A grunt. "What is it y'all do, over at that mosque or whatever?"
"Fracking,"
Rinpoche said with an enormous smile. "No way." The man flexed his forearms, and until my brother-in-law spoke again, appeared ready to inquire about work.
"Inside the person fracking, we put on the pressure and things inside come out."
"Like what things? Which kind of things?" As I somehow knew he would, Rinpoche reached across the counter, and with one hand, fingers splayed, grasped the man's skull, just above the forehead, palming a basketball. The man frowned and leaned back, out of reach.
"Sit, sit, meditate, meditate, fracking, fracking, and all the old ways to think come out. Makes you a new man. Jesus say so."
Suspicion had now been replaced by abject confusion. The waiter looked at me, at the dark-eyed girl clutching her stuffed mouse, at the stunningly beautiful middle-aged woman in a hippie dress, then back at the monk who'd given him a big tip and fondled his head. He said, "Well, the Jesus part I could maybe relate to, but the rest of it all, you know, that's some weird shit, man."
"Best shit ever," Rinpoche said agreeably. "Bet your yes."
A woman waiting behind us in line coughed and scowled. The waiter laughed nervously, as if another part of his body might suddenly be taken hold of if he kept on with the conversation. We thanked him, wished him luck, headed for the door, and had nearly made it when a leather-clad motorcycle couple, fresh from the famous Sturgis rally, crowded through, all wind-burned cheeks and coal-black boots. Like most of the rally-goers, they weren't part of some organized gang, just people who enjoyed riding in the open air. I knew this, and was all set to offer them a hearty North Dakota good morning when the woman muttered, "Freak show," as we passed. No one else in our group seemed to hear. 5. As we left the skillet's lot and climbed the shallow rise of 85 South, fields of gold and green parted before us like the Red Sea. 18-wheelers rushed past in the opposite direction, and every time she felt the car rock a bit from the air they pushed, Shelsa made a noise like, "Ooh!" There were a lot of bikers, too, the road so straight for so long, they appeared, at first, like a new species of ant out there in the shimmering distance. Once in a great while, we passed a modest farmhouse, built close to the road in the days when it had been red dirt. Some of these had been abandoned, overtaken by weeds and weed trees. Windows of empty glass, roofs sagging. They put me in mind of lonely old men, all of modern life rushing past as they huddled in their broken bodies, watching, watching, awaiting extinction. With my eyes on the tar strip and my thoughts running along such happy lines, I had a desire to engage Rinpoche in conversation. The man had a way of shining lamplight into the cavern of self-pity, making me see the world's sorrows from a different angle. But he'd decided to sit in back with his daughter for this leg of the journey. They both loved an elaborate form of Himalayan tic-tac-toe that was played in three dimensions with a plastic apparatus that resembled a miniature jungle gym. Mock, it was called, and it was ideal for a long trip, because one game or match could take 30 minutes or more to complete. Cece was riding shotgun, hands folded in her lap. She said, "I found an old-style hotel for tonight. Lots of character. I think you'll like it."
"Where?"
"Deadwood, South Dakota. I thought we were headed for the mountains."
"Eventually.
But there's an easy bus back to Dickinson from Deadwood, so we can spend the night with you there, then head home."
"I figured Wyoming, Montana, maybe."
"You have a touch of mockery in your voice, brother."
"Sorry."
I watched the telephone poles go past, cedar crucifixes holding wires of charged atoms, voices, information, life. I think I should be allowed one period of mockery daily, with a 30-minute maximum, because I agreed to take the road trip to nowhere. I think it only fair that I have a mockery allowance, or at least an irony allowance. One can't survive in Greater New York without it.
"Mock,"
Shelsa said from the back seat. It meant she'd won the first round. I, on the other hand, had not. My sister had fallen silent and was looking straight ahead. To our left, donkey derricks pumped away like nodding cartoon animals. You couldn't travel anywhere in North Dakota now without being reminded of the liquid and vaporous treasure that lay below the surface. Lucky farmers were making millions, and the nation was approaching fossil fuel self-sufficiency. "In Bismarck," I said, hoping to make peace. "I stopped in to see my friend Sia. You know, the guy who runs the coffee shop."
"I adore him," Cece said. "We always go there when we're in. Shelsa loves those flavored Italian sodas."
He was telling me horror stories about the way the state has changed. He was saying that just across the street from his place, the police stopped a van filled with prostitutes being sent up to the Bakken. 6 women, 3 from Russia and 3 from the Philippines. Cece didn't reply or move her eyes from the road. For a moment, I worried she didn't want me talking about such things with an earshot of her daughter. But then I remembered another parental quirk of their family. They talked about everything, everything, in front of Shelsa. Sometimes I thought they took a good approach too far. Not the kind of thing that used to...
"We're moving," my sister said.
I glanced at Rinpoche in the mirror. He was immersed in his mock.
"I was going to talk with you about it, but I wanted you to enjoy the farm, in case it was your last visit."
"You want to close the meditation center? And go where? What about Tasha? Warren?"
"The feeling of the place has changed, Otto. We've had some incidents."
I could feel a primal, fatherly instinct rousing itself from sleep. "Such as?" A pause. A glance over her shoulder at the mock players. So there were some things she didn't want Shelsa to hear.
"Natasha's safe," she said quietly. "We had a security system installed."
A security system. I suddenly wanted to turn the SUV around. My parents hadn't locked their doors, ever. It was a point of pride. When I'd first moved to New York and come back to visit, my father's opening remark was, "I hear they have deadbolts on the doors, even inside the apartment buildings. Is it true?" accompanied by a knowing smirk with, "Life is better."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.